My name is Michael Powell, and I've been with Eric for state taxes for a number of years on the board, and I'm from Brownberry, Democratic Club, and I'm glad to be here tonight. One of the things that interests me is particularly is the tax, the taxes that we're going to see next year. Just to give you a little example of what we're going to be facing next year in our office, is we have the concession system, this would be a concession system. We have 8.75% of the sales tax. Okay? That's what we're paying now. That's what we'll be paying next year as well. There's also a 15%, going to be a 15% retail tax. Statewide Texas retail tax. There's a $9.25 cultivation fee at the distributor level. That's $9.25 an ounce. There's also a $2.75 fee at an ounce per trail. We're testing in this, it's going to be $407 a pound for testing. That's an estimate. And we're talking about all these. In addition, there's going to be $150 a pound of water.
I'll just clarify that. I added up this way. Start with around 9% in San Francisco, but all medical patients are paying now. I estimate that in San Francisco, the taxes starting next year will reach about almost 60%. There are additional local excise taxes being introduced if they're not already existing in certain cities. Already San Jose has 10%, Oakland and Berkeley charge 5%. That's probably why cannabis is cheaper in San Francisco for medical patients than in other parts of the Bay Area. I think this is going to be a sticker shock. If any of you are medical patients, I recommend you consider buying your cannabis before December 31st. I estimate a 50% increase possibly coming in the price of cannabis. So an eight that's normally $40, an eight and an ounce of flower, make up to 60. $30 up to 45, that kind of thing.
Hello, my name is Brandon Howland. I'm an attorney here in San Francisco. Thank you everyone for coming out of time to hear us and to get your questions answered and find out information about what's happening here in San Francisco and in the state of California with cannabis. My background is I've been working as an attorney here at medical cannabis for the last 12 years or so, approximately, working with a lot of dispensaries on land use and permitting issues, as well as other compliance issues that arise with things like taxes, business structure, you know, partnerships, operations, landlord relationships, et cetera. And right now we're in the process of navigating, you know, a state, basically, you know, the state's taking over the regulation of cannabis and medical cannabis, but also adult use cannabis at the same time. So as you can imagine, when you go from, you know, like a small local ordinance like San Francisco's had in the past, let's say 12 years or so, to big statewide system for adult use and medical cannabis. That's a big transition. There's a lot of territory to cover. Everything from the seed to the shelf, and that includes testing, transportation, and quality assurance, all that stuff. As well as trying to balance the marketplace so it can be fair and competitive, and not just run out the small cultivators or distributors that have been in business for the last 7 years at least. So it's quite a challenge, and I'm working with most of these people up here on the stage. I'm pretty honored to actually sit here with them. We founded a few of us here in the room founded the Brown Area Democratic Club together. Real proud of that, and I worked with Asa back in the days, and we're also continuing every day to take on new projects and try to assure that good small businesses come to San Francisco that are run by good responsible business people, and that the cannabis can be looked on like any other business, looked upon like any other business. And if anything, looked on as even more favorably because of the challenges that are overcome and overcoming the stigma attached to it, having to go the extra mile to prove to the community that there is a place for cannabis and responsible operations. Thanks.
I'm not a microphone guy because I'm loud enough as it is. My name is Connor Johnston, and until about 6 months ago, I was the chief of staff to the president of the Board of Supervisors, London Breed, your neighboring supervisor in District 5. I left in about early April and started a consulting firm, consulting for cannabis companies across the state. And primarily, I help them navigate local regulatory issues, figure out the best place for them to locate in terms of different municipalities, as well as the different zones within that municipality and then the specific building, and get through the process from conception to doors opening. So work closely with Brendan. He and I share a lot of the same clients and all these guys at the table. And I'll just say, for the purposes of introduction, to frame the conversation, cannabis legalization isn't necessarily about expanding the universe of people who use it or expanding the usage rate of cannabis, though that will and is happening. It's really about a competition between the regulated market and the illicit market. And if you use last year's figures, in North America, the cannabis market overall was about $57 billion to the B. California is the largest single market amongst that continent. About $7 billion of that $57 billion was regulated. About $50 billion was illegal. So the process that we're undertaking in Canada and around the 29 states in the US and soon to be more states is to move from that illegal, unregulated, dangerous, environmentally damaging, illegal market towards a regulated, functioning market where you can have consistent quality, have environmental protections, workplace protections, job security, and benefit the tax base as opposed to benefiting drug cartels. So that's really what inspires me about this process, is that it's an issue whose time has long since come, and it's good to see San Francisco, by and large, at the forefront of that.
I will use a mic. My name is Dominic Rupoli. I am a cannabis political legal consultant, and I think that the past panelists have said quite a lot, and I have a bunch of opinions about cannabis, but I'm more interested in hearing what everyone else here wants to know, and so I'm just going to leave it at that and enjoy our conversation to come.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Aaron Ash. I'm a law student here at San Francisco, right at Bowie University. I'm also working with a cannabis consulting firm here in the city. And my last two internships in law school were with public defender's offices. So at this present time, I kind of come at the cannabis regulation from a social justice perspective, seeing firsthand the toll that the war on drugs has taken on a lot of people. And we're in a very interesting time now with San Francisco just proposing a pretty robust equity program to address the people who were hurt the most by the war on drugs. So I think it's a good discussion to have, and I'm happy to see that cities are taking that out.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ken Seligson. I'm also a law student at Golden Gate University. I'm also the president of the Students for Sensible Drug Policy. Through that organization, I've develop these relationships with the rest of the panelists here. I work for a cannabis consulting firm here in San Francisco. I also work for an attorney who practices in the cannabis industry. I think it's really important that we get together and we discuss these regulations, we talk about it, so that we can advocate for change at the local level and at the state level. The people who are drafting these regulations, they're listening to what we're saying. So it'd be great to hear your input so that we can bring what you guys have, what your perspective is, to the table, and hopefully create a general set of laws that is good for the general process and the industry in itself.
So I'd like to begin by talking about what's happening currently in San Francisco. Currently, we have a 45-day moratorium on the permitting of new retail medical cannabis dispensaries. First of all, there's a distinction between adult use and medical use. Right now, thanks to Prop 64 AUMA, the Adult Use and Marijuana Act, anyone 21 and over can legally possess cannabis. You can give it to someone else who's the same age or older. They can give it to you. But until next year, you're not going to be allowed to purchase it. And Right now, we have dispensaries that are planning to be before the Planning Commission. That is, these are dispensary applicants. The moratorium grandfathered in four dispensary applicants that are going before the Planning Commission, or were once going before the Board of Supervisors on an appeal of their Planning Commission approval in the month of October. On October 3rd, Apothecary, which is trying to open a dispensary in the Sunset, has their appeal hearing before the Board of Supervisors. On October 12th, there's a dispensary, Barbary Coast, that wants to open out on Irving at 2165 Irving Street in the Sunset District, and they have their hearing before the Planning Commission. 2 weeks later, on October 26th, Connected SF, which is at 5 Leland Avenue in the Bayshore, and SBA Wellness, I believe it's at 3105 San Bruno Avenue, also in the Bayshore area, will have their hearings before the Planning Commission. And that will be it until the moratorium was lifted. The reason the moratorium was passed, ostensibly, was to give the Office of Cannabis time to come up with a regulatory scheme, which has just been introduced through the city bureaucracy. Went before today, before the Planning Commission. It's a work in progress. It's obviously going to be subject to change by members of the Board of Supervisors. Even the leading proponent of it, Jeff Sheehy, acknowledges that there are things in it that he'd like to see change. One thing that strikes me is that it's important for people to weigh in. You will have an opportunity, I believe it's on October 3rd, is that correct? To go to the Board of Supervisors and give input on it. You can read the regulations as they're being proposed online, and you can find out about the different licensing structures. What's coming down from licensing is the following. Currently, we have a retailing process, a permitting process for retailing of medical cannabis dispensaries, like the four that are going before the Planning Commission this coming month. But we don't have licensing that's required by state law for cultivation, transportation, distribution, testing, and manufacturing. Manufacturing refers to the creation of concentrates in edible and tincture and topical forms of cannabis. There's also no licensing structure for public consumption yet, and there's no licensing structure for adult use retailing. That is, for people 21 and up, not patients, who would want to go into a store or what we may still have, dispensary and buy cannabis. Right now, the dispensaries don't have an automatic right to sell to adult users. The city will obviously make them go through a process of getting, I believe, a temporary cannabis business permit, and probably then will have to go through, most likely, some sort of hearing to expand their reach from just selling to medical cannabis patients to selling to adult users 21 and up. So I think at this point, I want to point out there are certain things coming in proposed statewide regulations that may be of concern to you. You will not be allowed, if the current regulations that are being proposed by the state for medical cannabis consumption are put through, there will not be any freebies. You won't be able to get free samples at dispensaries or discount coupons, things like that. You won't be able to directly touch the product on a shelf like at a supermarket where you pick up and put in your basket what you want. Currently, there's a dispensary called Harvest that allows you to do that before you go to the counter and pay for that. That will, if the regulations are approved on the state level, will not be permitted anymore. You'll have to go up to a counter, they'll have to bring it out to you, show it to you the way most dispensaries do, and then you'll decide whether to purchase it or not. Does anyone else want to chime in?
We should open it up to questions.
Open up to questions. Michael, why don't you talk? Denise?
So to distribute the cannabis in large amounts, we have to go through the gatekeepers at the alcohol and beverage control, am I right? Only alcohol distributors are allowed to distribute cannabis, is that true?
Yes, so it has since been removed once the governor reconciled his bill. He reconciled SB 94, which was the trailer bill. So now no longer is it a requirement that the alcohol industry distribute. You can actually be your own distributor, and there's no requirement anymore. That was in the medical law because of lobbying at the state level, and Prop 64, which we all passed as citizens of California, did not have that included. So when the governor reconciled his two bills together, what we were left with is that each individual licensee can apply for and distribute their own cannabis, and they could also distribute the cannabis of other individuals.
I guess I had a question for the law student. You mentioned social justice, if I hear you correctly.
Yeah.
To what degree will the movement for decriminalizing use of marijuana re-enfranchise the population most associated with an African-American people? You're shaking. I don't understand your hands in that. Are you saying something to me?
I'm sorry to say that Prop 64 has more jail than we had before. It has more jail time than we had before. It has very little to no wealth distribution.
I recognize there's an equity clause on here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So my question is, like, the panel here itself, all I see is a burgeoning billion-dollar industry with nothing reflective of the people who are most disenfranchised from using marijuana.
Yeah, so I think that's what the cities are trying to do now. In San Francisco's most recent proposed regulations that they put out for the entire first year of permits being given out, they can only be given out to equity applicants, people with pre-existing dispensaries who get a temporary permit, and also those entities who were shut down due to prosecution after 1996, the Compassionate Use Act. So San Francisco has actually taken the strongest stance on this, where they're gonna, for the first year, you basically have to be an equity applicant. And what equity means in San Francisco, they haven't defined yet, but in Oakland, that is defined as someone who falls below a certain income threshold. I think it's 80% of them, it has to be below 80% of the median income. And then also, they have to either live in certain police beats that are traditionally targeted by the police or have a conviction for a cannabis-related crime. And the reason I feel like a lot of cities would, if they could, say, we want to focus on minority communities that have been affected the most by
Can you use the word people of color?
People of color, yeah.
If you're a minority,
For people of color, in California, the Constitution prohibits discrimination based on race. So they're trying to fine tune it to really reach to reach people of color and give them the opportunities before Wall Street people come in, before people with money come in. And I think that's really important. And I'm sure it's gonna piss some people off, but I think it's what we have to do to reconcile the terrible abuse that's gone on from the government, from police departments all across the country, but especially in urban communities here in California.
Okay.
Can I ask one last question along the line?
Sure.
I understood in Oakland when they tried to implement an equity clause and it was compromised to a degree. So can you talk about that?
I can respond to that. Oakland requires that for every non-equity permit, let's say to open, let's say a cultivation site, there must be with it an equity permit holder. And again, equity permit holders are people who've been victims of the drug war in Oakland, who live in certain areas of Oakland. Parts of East and West Oakland are covered under that. And I think it's not the best way to go about this. If I were in charge of how equity would be run, I would recommend an assistance program for people who qualify for the equity permit based on drug war issues or minority status or income status. I would recommend a financial assistance program in the form of loan interest loans and a mentoring program to help them navigate the process of becoming business people. I think when you require one equity permit for every one non-equity permit, it will stymie growth. And many cannabis industry folks in Oakland have concerns about that. that happen in Oakland, and I'd like to see us do it differently here in San Francisco.
Yeah, I just want to jump in, ma'am, because I'm really glad you asked these questions, and I want to preface this by saying, I apologize for the preponderance of white dudes on this panel. it makes me a little bit uncomfortable, but I want to disabuse people of the idea that that's representative of what the industry looks like writ large. It's not. There are a lot of very successful people of color and LGBT business people in this industry, and we need more, and we need to rectify a lot of the wrongs that happened over the course of the last century. And the truth is that the premise of your question, ma'am, is 100% correct. The war on drugs and the criminalization of marijuana, as it was called at the time, that preceded it, were 100% about racism. The criminalization of marijuana originally started because it was associated with Mexicans who had come across the border in the early 20th century, which is actually about when my own family came across the border. And it was criminalized in a lot of ways to displace or to condemn them. And as the decades went on, we then heard it actually from the horse's mouth. You saw this recent article in which John Ehrlichman of Watergate fame was quoted as explicitly saying, the Nixon campaign in 68 and the Nixon administration subsequent to that campaign had two enemies, opponents of the war and black people. And we knew that we could not criminalize them directly, so we publicly associated them with marijuana for hippies and with heroin for black people. And we consistently raided their houses, disrupted their meetings, and made the population scared of them. And it was a political strategy. And that has been the case for the decades since the Nixon administration. You know, black people are four times more likely to be arrested for marijuana infractions or violations, even though they use the plant at a comparable rate as white people. We now imprison a higher percentage of our black population in America than South Africa did under apartheid. We have by far the highest imprisonment rate of any country in the world, even exceeding Russia. And that is largely because of these institutionally racist policies criminalizing drugs and criminalizing what is fundamentally either a freedom of choice issue or a medical issue. And so when I mentioned that I'm happy to see this legalization process come forward, that it's an effort whose time has long since come, that is a big factor in why I say that. You know, I worked for an African-American woman who grew up in public housing here in San Francisco, grew up extremely poor, and has been able to overcome that and rise to a prominent position in City Hall. And I have to tell you, I don't think I really wrestled with the institutional racism in this country until I came into the cannabis industry and started to research the history of the war on drugs. It's appalling what has happened in this country, and this is an opportunity to fix that and to provide opportunities to people who have long been victims of this institutional racism. So that's an inspiring thing to see unfold, and it's really important that we get those policies right so that we're creating those opportunities.
And to that end, San Francisco's policy has not yet been fully established. And as you can see, it's a pretty dynamic issue. So there's a lot of debate over what the equity program is going to look like. And so this is something to get involved with if you have an opinion about it, or you have a view of what we think the direction of this program should go, it's a very good opportunity to get involved and help shape that program because it's not yet been shaped.
I have a comment to add to this lady. 80% of the taxes for Prop 64 cannabis that will be sold will go to militarize the police. The other 20% is going to rehabs. You know, so I thought I'd add that.
Question, and ma'am?
Yes, I wanted to ask you about Drug Policy Alliance. Do you know what the money trail is for Drug Policy Alliance? Where do they get their money?
We're not here to discuss the Drug Policy Alliance. I think it's inappropriate since none of us here represent that organization to speak for it. So let's move on to another question, please.
And the back.
Hi. There's all these wonderful stories from the gold rush about how the people who were directly involved in the gold rush mostly lost their shirts. Didn't make any money. The people who really made the money were the ones selling the shovels and the wagons and the other things that supported that industry. What are the industries that are likely to be affected by the cannabis industry and perhaps your office opportunities?
Well, things you can do to find out about this is to attend a cannabis trade show. October 13th, 14th, and 15th at the Marriott Hotel in Oakland on 9th and Broadway, close to 12th Street Park, is going to be the New West Summit. And the New West Summit is a convention focusing on technology and cannabis and how those two industries are overlapping and working together. And on Sunday, October 15th, there is a consumer day where you'll be able to go there and the focus will be on consumers of cannabis-related businesses. I know that there are software companies making point-of-sale software for cannabis. There are a lot of companies that make pipes, that make vaporizers, that there are consultants that help people find property, right, and help people with regulations like Connor.
Can I take this? The cannabis industry will need everything that every other industry needs. So if you're in the broccoli industry and you're in the chain of supply, you're going to need a bunch of other ancillary businesses to help you operate your business. All of those, from consultants to tax collectors to tax lawyers, are going to be required, and there's all types of opportunity. It's really up to your imagination what these people would need as a service or a product, because if another industry like cannabis, which is produce agriculture, also requires a particular a service or product, then cannabis will most likely need it somewhere in their chain of supply as well.
It's my understanding that cannabis retail cannot open bank accounts and that they deal strictly in cash. Are they going to be able to open banking accounts eventually?
I mean, right now the short answer is no. The question was that currently, because cannabis is against federal law, use of cannabis and protection of cannabis, that the banks do not allow cannabis businesses to bank with them. And so what happens is a lot of the cannabis businesses, or all the cannabis businesses, are forced to use cash, you know, in lieu of banking. So she asked if there's a solution in sight. And you know, the short answer is no. This is something that all of us, the legal industry, and that represent cannabis businesses have spent thousands of hours, to the point where I can't even do conference calls on this issue anymore. I had to explode. But I mean, there's little small progress being made. I know like there are some pilot programs that certain community banks are trying, and other states are a little ahead of us. Once there's a regulated market in place, that's something that takes a little pressure off. California had this kind of hodgepodge of laws where there wasn't a state regulatory program in effect. So, that makes us comfortable.